Hi there. Welcome to Tuck Talk Weekly. I'm Bob from Creation Station. This is our weekly show where we give you three, sometimes four interesting news stories, get you on your way with a fun library fact in only about 20 minutes. As always, if you have a story you'd like us to cover, creationstation@brower.org comes right to me. Today, I have Miss Jill Sears, the Assistant Director for Brower County Library Systems. How are you doing today, Jill?
I am doing fantastic. How are you, Bob?
Life has been great. So tell everybody what the difference is in an assistant director versus a director of what's going on with the library system.
Well, as the assistant director, I deal almost exclusively with public service. All the branches, the service you all are getting in the branch, if you're having a problem, you let me know.
It's been running pretty smooth lately. It's been going along. Everybody's been adjusting to this, to the new way of doing things. I hate calling it the normal. It's not normal, but we don't want to go back to normal either. But we're making a new way. We're making a new thing of making it all successful for everybody this time. At least I hope so.
We are.
Yeah. We've got some fun stories today. This first one is one of those weird, cool stories that I like to feature when I find them. It's a fish that swims on its own with heart muscles. And this is something, I think this is one of those stories that, in upcoming years, they're going to look back and say, oh, well, that's when that happened, as this little piece of history thing. Did you, what do you think about this whole idea of just being able to use hearts to as locomotion?
It's absolutely amazing. It fascinated me. I learned a lot about the heart, how the heart works, and the implications for medical use and helping people with heart damage. I can see, it's not just fascinating and really a quirky, interesting thing, but I think it can be put into real life medical uses.
Yeah, here we got a video up there for you to show this just swimming along on its own. This is, there's no wires, there's no guiding, there's no nothing. It's just, as you get in a chance to read the articles, as always, we'll put all the links in the show notes for you. The two different types of heart muscles beating against each other creates the ability for the fish to just swim. And it's this whole little artificial swim that can do. And like you said, just being able to grow these, basically from stem cells, and be able to create and grow and build them on their own without having to do any extra work to get it to move, to get it to react. It's really nice, isn't it? I'm just, like you said, fixing heart muscles. I can think of, just the idea of robots and all the other things being able to just let them grow on their own. All it needs is a little bit of nutrients in the fluid, just like your own muscles, and it keeps on growing and doing. Would make the robots a little less scary if they all have flesh on them like
I don't know if it would make them less scary.
that. We're getting closer to Frankenstein than we are to
That's what was going through my mind.
It's gonna be crazy. And along the lines of strange new animals, there's also the whole list of old animals that we don't know where they are. So part of this example is out they this group, the Search for the Lost Species, and it is put out by the International Union of Conservation of Nature. They put together a list back in 2017 of all these species that are not, you can't see anymore, that you can't find. Or maybe, and that was the whole goal. Is it something that is extinct? Is it just hidden away? None of them had been seen for at least 10 years, and some of them 200 years. And then they start finding them. Give people a challenge. Here, go out and look, go search and find. You had one that you liked that you found out there, huh?
Yeah, the silverbacked, I don't know if I'm pronouncing this right, chevrotain, or a deer mouse, much easier for me to pronounce. It hadn't been spotted in 48 years. And the reason why it became so scarce was because of the indiscriminate hunting ways they were hunting in that Southeast Asia area. They were just using tripwires, and just killing anything and everything, whether they needed to eat it or not. So it is a lesson to us to be careful with all our resources, our wildlife, our natural resources, and be thoughtful and strategic about how we use them. But this little deer mouse is so cute. It just fascinated me. It's a deer about the size of a rabbit or a cat, and it's got two little fangs that come out of its little mouth. I hope everyone that's listening will look it up. It's so
I
cute. It's
am
adorable.
going, you know what? Now you just made me think about it. I'm going to go bring that link up right now to show
Okay.
people what it actually looks like. Oops, is
And
it there?
I had to get a few different pictures on different websites to really get to see its little two little
It's it
fangs.
is a tiny little thing, yeah. And it's just got that weird little bit in there. There is the one that I thought was interesting was this one that they highlighted in this article here, looking for the blind salamander, because it's the North American one, and it's not that it probably is still around. It's so hard to get to where it is. Because you have to go down into the aquifers underneath everything before you can even get a chance to find it. So that right there was like, it's a good reminder of just what could be out there and what's possible to that we don't even know because we can't get to like down in the deep, depths of the oceans. You know, when you get into those deep canyons and stuff like that, or even this, where it was just the only time we've ever seen one of them was once 70 years ago. And that's it. The
Amazing.
only time we've ever seen this entire species. Just craziness. For your library tidbit for the day, Last Chance to See is a great book and BBC series to check out and read. Have you seen that series, Jill?
I have not, but I'm going to look
It's,
for
you know, it's a great thing. The BBC teamed up a couple people, Douglas Adams, the science fiction writer, to go off and hunt the last chance to see these six different animals in the wild. And then they redid the thing that they redid it 15, 20 years later, and they found fewer of the animals. So it was really an interesting just examination. And it's got a little bit of humor and some good science stuff into it. So it was a really fun series for that.
Well,
So
I'm
definitely go
hoping that
check these
we
animals
can
out.
find the ivory-billed woodpecker.
Do you think it's really there?
I don't know. It is thought to be extinct,
I
but
don't
it
know.
would
They
be a
keep having
wonderful
those
thing.
sightings. For anyone who's not familiar, the ivory-billed woodpecker is a native to North America. It is common throughout the southern United was common throughout the southern United States, and it is still maybe out there in some of the swamps in Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana.
Yeah, they think it might be, but nobody's seen one for quite some time.
They've got some recordings of vocalizations that they suspect might be it, but they're not positive. That's another one of these things. See, we could just go on for hours. We'll just have a whole show just on animals one day.
Know we
We'll
should.
just we'll find it. And then we've got a slightly less happy story, to say the least. Who owns your body parts? And are they required to keep them running? The story today that we've got is Second Sight, which is a company that has now gone out of business, and they did retinal implants for people so that you could use. I'm going to scroll down to see if there's a picture of you could just use it like normal. Your eyes, everything looks normal, and by using this implant, it allows your retina to start to see vague shapes, no colors. But you can see light and dark and some things like that. So it restores vision to people who are totally blind. But the company that made them, makes them, went out of business. And now people's eyes are stopping working.
That's so incredibly sad for people that started to have some vision and spent quite a bit of money getting these devices and learning how to use them. And so I think a little bit of a cautionary tale.
Yeah, I think, and that's kind of where why I found the story. I was like, it's a sad story, but beyond that, it is the whole idea of, I mean, how many people out there have pacemakers or have other devices that they're using? We did a whole show on robotics back in November. We're gonna do, that was prosthetics in November, and this month in February we're doing robotics. And for those assistive devices and things like that, if it's something that you can take off, at least you don't have it stuck in your body the whole time. But this is something that's implanted inside of you, just like a pacemaker, just like these things. We talked about a story last year about some biohackers that were hacking into some of these devices to be able to intercept the signals. So it's one of those things where people really have to think about where are you going with this technology? What are you building? What are you growing into? I definitely would have signed up if I needed this. I mean, both my
Sure.
grandparents were blind growing up, so I know exactly what it's like to have that loss, and I know you can operate just perfectly fine with it, but to lose it later on in life would be very different. And to get it back and then have it taken away again. What are the options? What do you think, Jill? What are some of the options that you think could be done for that?
You know, I was wondering about that. Maybe are there startup companies out there that would want to take over the technology and work with these people? The only other option I see, and when I read the article, one woman, her option was to have the device removed because there was no more support, technical support for it, and it wasn't working. But she decided rather than go through another surgery, she would just leave it in there. I
And you
think.
have something like that that's got, and it's got power. It's connected. It's got, things that can deteriorate, et cetera, over time.
I think the future of this sort of thing, and the article alluded to it, it will be more like a brain implant rather than, these device other types of devices.
Yeah, it is, and I'm torn on the idea of, like you said, do you make a company keep supporting a product anymore? We don't require Apple to keep supporting old phones. And in this case, for this company, they folded their company because they were bought out by another company, and essentially they bought them for their patents, and then said, okay, we're not going to run the rest of that side of the company. We're not going to be doing that anymore. So maybe that's where regulations need to step up. If you're going to allow someone to buy a medical company like that, the person, maybe that purchasing company needs to be able to maintain and keep it running.
Possibly so, yeah.
It gets to that, and it gets to those thorny issues of what's the ethical side of things for both the consumer, the insurance company, the company that's putting this out? Because, as you said, I mean, these are, how many hundreds of thousands of dollars sometimes for some of these devices, and the insurance company's paying almost all of that. So why would we, you would think the insurance company would want somehow to maintain those things. Can you think of any
Yeah.
other devices that are like that?
No, I can't. They do have like device brain device that is implanted in the brain for people with Parkinson's disease to
Oh,
stop the
okay.
tremors. And of course, pacemakers. I'm
Yeah,
sure there
that's
are
the one that
things
came to my
the
mind was a
cochlear
pacemaker. So,
implants. Yeah, there are
oh,
things out there,
hey,
but
yeah.
I think they're more, I don't know if they are on the same, they use the same technology as the second
Yeah,
sight
if they're as
devices.
connected. Yeah.
Right.
I wonder if those hearing devices, I wonder if those are connected or if they are just purely simple devices that are self-contained.
Yeah, that's a good question.
Because if they would require power, like if there's a little mini battery in there or something like that, then I wonder, would that be something that could also be an issue for someone? I know a couple of people, friends online, who have had those cochlear implants. I never thought to ask how it's powered.
It looks like the device is implanted in the ear, and there's a secondary device outside
At the
the ear.
outside. So the secondary device must be the thing that has the power and things like that,
Yeah,
then.
that's what it looks like. Just a cursory quick look on Mr. Google,
Yeah.
Dr. Google. It is an electronic device.
That is going to be a puzzle. All of our new strange technology worlds that we're living in, huh? All these fun things. I did want to share out for us the search for that book that I mentioned earlier, Last Chance to See. We do have that here in the library, of course. And we also have the DVDs but Stephen Fry did a follow-up on the book, like I had said. 1991 was the original Last Chance to See, and then they redid it in 2010. So stop by broward.org/library and you can put that book on reserve, get it in for yourself, or grab the DVDs as you want.
And you can put it on reserve from your home and then come in and pick it up when we have it for you.
Exactly. What else we got going on around the library system, Jill?
So much. I believe it'll be next Friday, February 25th. Believe it or not, is next Friday. The month is
Yeah.
almost over. Here, next to the main library at the Fort Lauderdale Women's Club, we have a live storytelling event, Moonlight Tales. It's stories for adults, not adult stories, but stories for adults and live music. And it's free, so I hope our listeners come out and enjoy a night under the stars. We're returning in person. Last year we had to do it online, but we're happy to be back in person. Our African American Research Library and Cultural Center is celebrating their 20th anniversary this year. It's hard to
That's
believe.
another that is that insane?
I know.
I opened that building, I'm like, wait, how, huh? What?
Where did those years go? But I will tell you that building is still spectacular. It's
Oh
a
yeah.
beautiful building, and they have a year-long slate of really exciting events. So you can go to broward.org/library and see all their events they have planned for the year.
Yeah, it's going to be a really fun thing. We did the 2 weeks a week ago, 2 weeks ago when we did the rededication, and
Yes.
there's a whole list. The Esther role play is coming back. That was a big thing a couple of years ago, that we're bringing that one back this year. So yeah, there's amazing things. And if you have not been to Moonlight Tales, you need to come down. Come on downtown to the Moonlight Tales, and it's just going to be gorgeous. It's going to be right down to Stranahan Park. Beautiful area nowadays. Everything downtown has been really cleaned up, and it's really come a long way over the last few years as all these new
It
buildings come
has.
in and everything.
Yeah, it's so nice to see people on the street. They're out there walking their dogs, pushing their babies in their carriages. It's really nice to see the streets full of people again.
Yeah, I always say, nobody drives downtown to go walk their dog. So, people are living there when people are walking their
Right.
dogs.
Yeah.
That's the way it is. Well, thank you so much, Miss Jill, for being here for this. We just flew through another 20 minutes really fast.
We
Let me
sure
throw
did.
up our end slide here. If you have a branch or a librarian you'd like to see featured, as always, creationstation@broward.org. Let me know and we'll try and get them on the air. Thank you guys very much. You have a
Thank
great
you,
day and
Bob.
stay safe.
See everyone.